This podcast is brought to you by the North Dakota Petroleum Foundation. From heating our homes and powering our vehicles to cell phones, clothing, and medical equipment, oil and natural gas makes everyday life better. North Dakota Oil and Natural Gas, advancing the possibilities. Learn more at ndpetroleumfoundation.org. Welcome to Plain Talk Live. I'm your host, Rob Port, and we got a good show. Jay Thomas is going to be joining me, which is always a good time because Jay's a lot of fun. Mondays, he does my show, I do his show. I don't know. It's a lot of fun. I like talking with Jay on Monday mornings as because most of the time Monday mornings, he and I would call each other anyway to figure out what are we going to talk about this week, to figure out show ideas and column ideas and everything else. Jay helps me a lot. I like to think I help him sometimes with topic ideas.
Oh, you too. Do.
Every
you
once do. In a while, I have a good idea. So this show, we're going to talk about these lawmakers who in Texas who fled the state of Texas in order to not allow a vote in Texas on some very important legislation. Agree with it or disagree with it. We're going to talk about it. Before we get there, actually just breaking news, and I have a column up about it as we're broadcasting this. You can read it at inform.com, Grand Forks Herald, Jamestown Sun, Tickets and Press. There's a recall petition has been filed with Secretary of State Al Jaeger's office for Dwight Kiefert, State Representative Dwight Kiefert. Now, you might remember Dwight's a Republican from Valley City, very conservative guy, who over the years, you know, has made some controversy. A few years back, he drew some ire for objecting to a Muslim person deliver a Muslim spiritual leader delivering the invocation at the legislature. You know, he's had some kind of adventures with Facebook, but his offending is not any of that stuff. Where he ran afoul of the people, and by the way, the person organizing the recall petition is the treasurer of the District 24 Republican Party. So, I mean, this is a Republican Party official, at least a local official, who is recalling one of the sitting lawmakers in his own district over the censure of Luke Simons, or excuse me, over the expulsion of Luke Simons earlier this year amid the revelation of a long history of harassment in the legislature. So, Jay, I mean, let's do a quick tally. We had and I don't know what you want to call them, the Bastiat caucus, the hardcore, when I say not, I call them Trump supporters. They're not people who support. They're people who are like down like the QAnon rabbit hole. Like that's who these people are. They tried to take over the North Dakota Republican Party this spring. They were censuring lawmakers this spring. Elements of this same movement. They're pushing the term limits ballot measure, which I don't know if you and I have talked about that yet. Maybe we might need to get into that. They're pushing the term limits ballot measure. They're pushing the recall of Governor Burgum, which is something that's going to require like 90,000 signatures. And now they're trying to recall Dwight Kiefert. And Jay, the North Dakota Republican Party is a mess right now.
I think both parties are a mess nationwide. It's just, and we'll get into the latest from the Republican Party on a national level, but. First of all, Dwight, if you're watching this, quit with the dances with Facebook, buddy. Okay,
he's done. I say that he's done pretty good over. He's cooled it with some of that stuff. Yeah, I think it's been several years now since we've had any of those issues. But I mean, this thing where, because let's face it, his stuff on Facebook, that never earned him a recall. What earned him a recall was voting to expel Luke Simons, and there's just a group of people who aren't going to let that go.
Yeah, I was going to say that they're still on this thing. It's done. It's over. This party is fighting amongst themselves, and keep pulling this garbage Republican Party in North Dakota, and you're going to end up losing seats, man. People are going to get fed up with it, because if you're doing all this infighting, you're getting nothing accomplished, and you've done a lot for the state of North Dakota. So just, man, just grow up for the love of God enough already.
Do you feel like, I mean, all of these things are coming, and it's just, it's, you know, they like to represent themselves as, well, we're the true conservatives. You know, we're just trying to get Republicans to follow the platform. But I look at some of the people they're fighting against, And they represent what I feel is what's made the North Dakota Republican Party successful. And I think a lot of it, Jay, is kind of your same approach to politics, where it's not really ideological per se. I think you're generally a kind of a conservative guy, but it's not, but a lot of it is just pragmatism, right? It's a lot of it's just the, what I like to call the, just plow the damn roads approach, right?
Yes.
We just need government to do some pretty basic stuff, you know, maintain the roads, plow the roads, you know, let's make sure the schools are funded appropriately. Let's try to keep taxes low. Let's make it easy to do business in our state. Like, it's simple stuff. I feel like the North Dakota Republican Party overall has done a pretty good job of focusing on that. And that's why they've been in office for like 3 decades now, or in power for 3 decades.
No, I think they've done a really good job. I mean, I don't agree with everything that the Republican Party does. I don't belong to any party. I mean, I'm a guy that leans right. And many people tell me I'm more libertarian than anything else. Yeah. But, you know, I'm probably 80% of the time I'm going with the Republican Party. But man, this fighting, it is so hard for me, Rob, to even turn on the news anymore, especially the talking heads, because it's just bicker, 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 bicker. And again, you know, you have the left against the right, right against the left, but now you're seeing in both parties, you're seeing the Dems just beating the hell out of each other now, and now the right is doing it. And now is the time on not just a North Dakota level, but a national level. Now is the time that you would think, Rob, that the Republican Party would be rallying together and get seats back and get control. Stop with the fighting and stop with the stupidness. They're getting nothing accomplished, and people are fed up. They're fed up with their own parties.
I think what people want is we want people to govern. Right.
Yes.
Like, let's address real problems. The before we move on to our topic, because our topic, I think, is very much in line with what we're talking about. Term limits, this term limits ballot measure. What do you think of it?
OK, I haven't really followed it a whole lot. I mean, what do they want to do?
So it's no more than 8 cumulative years in the legislature. In one chamber of the legisature. So if you hit your 8 years in the House, you could flip over and serve another 8 years in the Senate. And then it's 8 years for the governor, 2 terms for the governor and nobody else, which I thought was kind of odd. Like, why, if term limits are important for the governor, why not the attorney general? Why not the secretary of state? Why not the insurance commissioner? I don't understand that.
Yeah, because those people have just as much power as the lawmakers.
And then there's also, it gets grandfathered in. So it's kind of funny because there's a group of lawmakers who are on it. Some of whom have already served more than 8 years, Rick Becker and Ole Larson and some of these other guys.
Well, then why don't they leave? Why do they keep running if they're for term limits? What the hell are you guys doing? Come on, man.
Isn't that a good
hypocrites? Pack her up and call it a day. Don't run again.
Isn't that a good question? Why? If you have the courage of your convictions, if you think that you should only be in office for 8 years in the House chamber or the Senate chamber or what have you, then feel free to resign anytime. Feel free to set an example for the rest of us with your own actions and resign. But they actually get grandfathered in. So I was doing the math. I think Ole Larson.
They get grandfathered in.
The clock doesn't start ticking until after this amendment passes. So Ole Larson could still have a 20-year career in the state Senate even after this passes.
It's stuff like this. We're just us average everyday citizens who aren't, you know, I mean, we follow politics, but we're not, it's not our sport. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
But this is the stuff that just pisses us off because, again, well, we want an eight-year limit, but wait a minute, you guys have been in there for how long? I mean, come on, man, give it up then. When it comes to term limits, I'm kind of wishy-washy on this, and I'll tell you why. Because I look at it as, let's just go with North Dakota, not on a national level.
Sure.
Because we only meet every 2 years. Can you actually get what you want done in 8 years? When in that 8 years you've only met 4 times,
you know, there was a younger lawmaker, and I don't want to use his name because he didn't give me the quotes. We were talking off the record, but he made the point because he was elected in 2016, just got reelected in 2020. You know, he said, I'm in my final term now, And, you know, I should be looking at running for like majority leader or something. Because if you think about it, like the person who's going to serve as majority leader, if this were to pass, the person who's majority leader in like the House or the Senate isn't going to have any more than they're going to have been reelected once. And now they're the majority leader of the State House of Representatives. And who are we empowering? Like we're going to turn over the legislature, which, by the way, there are parts of the state where they're going to run into candidate recruitment problems in terms of finding people who have the time and the willingness, mm-hmm. and they're in the financial situation where they can serve in the legislature, because for that is not a lucrative position to serve in. You know, they're going to have candidate recruitment problems. And then also, who are you empowering, right? If you're turning everybody over, you know, every 8 years, the bureaucracy is going to be in charge, right? Because they're there for, and that's not me besmirching, you know, the people who work in our state government, who are 99% wonderful people, hardworking, dedicated people. But that's a power shift from the people who are elected to the people who aren't.
But, you know, again, you know, should somebody be in for 30 years? I think that's ridiculous. But again, when we have a legislative session that only meets every other year, again, if you're doing an 8-year term, unless you jump from one side to the other side, from House to Senate, set it up, you know, then you can get 16 possibly. It just, I don't know. 8 just doesn't seem like enough. It just doesn't. And if you're constantly overturning, I mean, look at now, we've got people, now we go to the national, you've got senators, congresspeople that have been in office for decades, and these people still can't get anything accomplished. If you're constantly turning over, and every time you turn over, you have a new set of ideas. That's on new ideas or things that are already in place, but now you want to turn it and change it around. I mean, here's a prime example. Look at the Dreamers DACA. Look what's going on with that. These folks that have been brought to this country when they were children, you know, now they're 20s, 30s, and their life is still in limbo, because every time you turn over power in Washington, things change. So you've got millions of people living in limbo. I mean, this is a whole other discussion, but it kind of goes into this whole term limit thing. So if you're doing that in North Dakota, how often are things going to be tossed in limbo?
Well, also, I mean, think about some of the areas where we make public policy, like think about public schools. How long does it take? I mean, you make education policy every 2 years, potentially. But yet it takes, how long does it take a student to work their way all the way through the case? It takes 13 years. So sometimes, even now, without term limits in North Dakota, you're talking over the course of you know, one cohort of students making their way all the way from kindergarten to graduating from high school. You know, we could turn over our education policy two or three times during that. You start, you know, doing term. So I just, it doesn't. Also, I think there's a will of the people, right? You look at somebody like Ray Holmberg up in Grand Forks, who's been, I think the first time he ran for the legislature, he was on the same ballot as Jimmy Carter. He's been there for a long time. Now, is that an inherently bad thing? Can you point to things that Ray Holmberg is doing that are not good? Or are the people of Grand Forks just happy with their senator? I mean, at what point is it just the will of the people?
Well, that's another thing. You bring up another good point, Rob. That is, if you go with term limits, and again, I'm kind of wishy-washy on this, because I get it. You look at some of these folks and go, okay, you've been in here how long? But are you taking away the will of the people? I mean, if the person's doing a horrible job, then the people will vote that person out. Yeah. So by limiting how long they can be in office, you're taking away our ability to say who we want to represent us.
What's interesting is the person who is the chairman of this constitutional amendment campaign is a guy by the name of Jared Hendricks, who's also kind of a mover and shaker for the Bastiats and all this stuff.
I know who he is,
all this stuff that we're talking about. He's from up here in Minot. And the funny thing is he's not from North Dakota. He came to North Dakota as a part of one of Ron Paul's presidential campaigns. He ran several of them. And then he had just ended up staying here. And what's interesting is that Ron Paul served in the United States House of Representatives from, like, I think it was like 1972 up until, what was it, 2012, 2013? I mean, he was there for decades.
That's a long time.
And the thing is I suspect that whatever you think, you may think of Ron Paul, or I may think of Ron Paul, or somebody listening to this may think of Ron Paul, his constituents were clearly satisfied with the job he was doing, because they kept reelecting him. And at the end of the day, shouldn't they be allowed to, if they wanted to keep reelecting somebody like that over and over again?
Well, that's what I'm saying. You know, you can look at both sides of the term limits. And again, you look at the, okay, if you're going to do these, then you're taking away the will of the people. And if the person that's been in there is not doing the job, then the people will vote that person out if a better candidate comes along. And that means, you know,
or you can even recall as some people are trying to do to Dwight Kiefert. And I think,
well, that's what they're doing here in Fargo for the four members of the Fargo school board.
And that's a process. And you and I can agree or disagree on whether or not those people ought to be recalled, but the process exists. They can gather the signatures. We can have the debate and that's fine. So there's nothing stopping the electorate from imposing term limits whenever they want. You know, it's called an election. So anyway, as usual, Jay and I agreed on a topic and then immediately went far
afield. Yeah, this is boring. Come on, man. Come on. I want to kick some poor arse, man. Come on.
All right. So let's talk about these people. Now, the Texas Democrat, and this is hilarious. They absconded from Texas in order to block the bill.
Are they still gone? Because the governor said, "I'm going to arrest you as soon as you step foot on Texas soil."
I don't think they've come back yet, and I don't know if I agree with it. Well, although, you know, earlier this year, I mean, that's a real thing, and that law exists in North Dakota too. If they do, what do they call it? I think they call it like a call of the House, earlier this year they did that when they were going to vote on the expulsion of Luke Simons earlier this year. And if lawmakers, I mean, because House Majority Leader Chet Pollard stood up and said, "I'm going to do a call of the House," right. And if not everybody was in their seats, they were going to send like the Highway Patrol to go track them down.
That's right.
So I mean, I think most legislatures in the country have that. But anyway, so these Texas Democrats, they abscond from the state. They go to Washington D.C. ironically to call for the end of the filibuster, which is just hilarious. Like they're doing a sort of illegal filibuster in Texas. To go to Washington to protest against a legal filibuster process. You can't make this stuff up. And then they spread COVID along the way because they weren't wearing masks or whatever.
These are the people that made sure that we stayed masked up, that, you know, get your vaccinations, do this. And these knuckleheads start spreading COVID amongst themselves.
Yeah, it's just unbelievable. So anyway, so you have that. But meanwhile, Senator Lindsey Graham is making the same argument that Republicans at the national level in the Senate ought to do the same thing to block a Democratic voting bill. And I got to tell you, Jay, whether it's Democrats proposing this or Republicans proposing it, I don't agree with it. I don't like this. You were elected to serve in the legislature.
Yes.
Serve in the goddamn legislature.
Exactly. I mean, come on. This is, we already know that Washington basically gets very little done because of the constant bickering. And now you got bickering within parties. But now the new thing is we're going to load up on a plane and we're just going to leave. And we're not going to be adults. We're going to be children. We're all sitting there going, you got to be kidding me. You got a job to do. You were elected to do something. You're paid pretty damn good. Well, I don't know if I would say damn good money, but you're paid to do a job. So this is the new game. And then, was it Lindsey Graham basically threatens to do the same thing? Come on, man. Two wrongs don't make a right. Don't follow this party, the Democratic Party, down the hellhole. And that's what you're doing. Stop with this stuff. Us Americans just want you people to get something accomplished.
But isn't this what, I mean, this seems to me what happens is you have Democrats do something like this. And then Republicans will decry what they're doing, but then they'll do the same thing. And then Democrats, and then it becomes like an arms race where it's just, they're just escalating one after another, you know, you impeached our guy, we're going to impeach your guy. You investigated us. We're going to investigate you. Just stop it and plow the damn roads. I'm going to start a political. It's called the Plow the Damn Roads Party. That's
get those t-shirts made up too. I'll proudly wear one of those. Yeah. Plow the Damn Road Party. Yeah. It's, You watch this, and I don't know if Lindsey Graham was, I mean, he sounded, you know, kind of serious, but I don't know if it was just more him showboating and saying, "Hey, look, you know, we can do the same thing to you.
Let's not give anybody the idea.
If they do it, that's just like, oh, come on, man. Really? You opened up this box now?
Yeah.
So now we, the people of America that pay our taxes, that go out, we work hard, we vote to put you people in, and now you've got this new game you're going to play, which means even less is going to get done. Enough already. Grow the hell up.
Yeah.
You're adults. Quit acting like you're fighting in the damn sandbox in kindergarten.
Well, here's the thing. We have a process for governing in this country, right? And it starts, we elect people, and those people go to legislative chambers, and those legislative chambers have rules and laws that they have to follow. And we go through that process, and we develop laws, and we develop policy. Sometimes you win, sometimes you lose. What worries me is that we're getting to a point where we don't respect the process at all. If we're going to lose through the process and it's going to produce an outcome that we don't like, well, then suddenly we declare the process invalid. We give ourselves permission to just not follow the rules anymore. And then when we stop following the rules, then why should the people on the other side follow the rules? Like, if we're not going to follow the rules, why should they? And then things just devolve into chaos.
We need to have the power to pull their paychecks and their benefits when they pull this crap. I mean, honestly, if I just decided one day, hey, Steve Hallstrom, it's Steve Hallstrom, if you don't know, folks, he's the guy that Scott Hennett, they run the radio stations here. I just said, hey, you know what? Yeah, Steve, I don't like that. I'm getting on a plane. I'm getting out of here. I'll come back to work when I agree with what you want to do. I'm done. I'm fired, rightfully so. And these people forget that they work for us. They have completely, they are so out of touch with America. And we're talking on all levels. Let me rip on this President Harris. Oh, I'm sorry, Vice President Harris. I mean, here's the Vice President of the United States. See, this is your coastal elites. The Vice President of the United States. And she actually says, voter ID. We can't do that because rural America doesn't have access to Xerox machines or Kinko's or Office Maxes. Are you flipping kidding me? Come on, man. These people have no clue when it comes to how Americans live. They have no idea. This is what they're going to do? Come on. Pull their check. If you don't do your job, guess what? You don't get paid. Now, some of them, it doesn't matter. They're gazillionaires. You know, more power to them. That's what makes America great, capitalism. Their checks, pull their benefits. Enough of this garbage.
Did you know that the first forerunner of the fax machine was actually in, like, the middle of the 19th century? Like, you could have really? Conceivably... They were still samurai in Japan when Abraham Lincoln wasn't president yet. There was about a 22 or 23-year period where a samurai in Japan could have sent a fax to Abraham Lincoln. That's how long fax technology. It used to be like telegram to text or something like that. But so you could. There was about a 20-year where you could have sent a samurai could have sent a fax to Abraham Lincoln. And she doesn't she doesn't think rural America has glommed onto this technology yet. We have combines that drive themselves with GPS, lady. We know what fax machines are.
These people are running the damn country right into the ground. And this voter ID, while I'm on a tie right now, this voter ID, how is it in 2021 we are still having this debate in America that it is wrong to make people have an ID to go vote? Voting is this precious thing. It's one of the great rights we have in this country.
Absolutely.
You have to have the ID for banking, for driving, and we are sitting here still having this debate. Here, I want to vote. I know my vote's important. Here's my ID. Thank you. Move on. Come on, man.
Well, it's amazing, too, is the way, because you had Joe Biden the other day, like, comparing Republican efforts to implement policies like voter ID or policies like, hey, maybe we don't need to mail in an absentee ballot to every single registered voter. You know, maybe we don't need voting polls to be open 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Maybe being open just 15 hours a day, 6 days a week is enough. You know, he's comparing, and we could debate about those policies, right? Yeah. You and I could take, but he's comparing them to Jim Crow. He's saying that this is the greatest threat to democracy since the Civil War.
If I'm a Black American, I'm hating these people right now because they're making Black America, because that's the argument they use. Well, the minorities, Black America can't get to the polls. They're being suppressed with voter ID. Black America's got to be livid with this administration going, what do you think? We're too dumb to get an ID. It was funny. I don't know if you saw this. It was last week. I can't remember what channel it was on. One of the news channels. And they were asking people on the street about voter ID and the fact that, you know, it's tough to get it. It suppresses minorities. And it was a black gentleman. And he's like, what? He goes, the DMV is right there. He points to it. It's right there.
Right over there. Yeah. There's a term for that. I think I remember George W. Bush saying it in a speech, but it's called the soft bigotry of low expectations, right? Where it's just sort of, we have to dumb everything down because these idiots that we supposedly care so much about can't take care of themselves. They couldn't possibly go out and get an ID. I'm sorry. I remember 2018 when Heidi Heitkamp was singing that tune and the Democrats were singing that tune here in North Dakota because our Native American friends and neighbors were supposedly not able to get. Is there a state in the country that's easier to vote than North? You don't even have to register.
No,
you have to have your voter. You have to have your ID. You have to have a state ID in line 30 days before the election. That's it. That's it.
Yeah. And that's if you can't afford it, it's free. Yeah. You can get one for free.
They don't even check. If you could afford it, you could probably get one for free. If you're willing to just lie on the form, they're not going to check. I'm not advocating that people do that, but for crying out loud. I mean, this is not a complicated process at all. And nor should it be.
I love it when you see folks like when it's MSNBC or CNN, they'll be interviewing people, ask them, why are you against voter ID? Of course, they're looking for the people that are against it. You know, they're, oh, it's too hard to get and it's expensive. And it's just, you know, the list goes on and on as they're sitting there with a $1,200 phone in their flipping hand.
Right. That they probably used to vote on American Idol or something.
Yeah,
I mean that's where they want it. Like they want it to be. And listen, I'm coming around on some of the other stuff that we're doing with voting. I'm very much a traditionalist. When I vote, I like to go down to the poll. I like to stand in line. I like to watch the people do it. I like to say hi to my former gym teacher, who's always a poll worker in my precinct. Yeah. I don't know. I like the pro because I am just in love with the American system of government. And I like to go. I mean, that's where the rubber meets the road. I like to be there for it. I like to show up. Now, during COVID, I ended up voting remotely because that was a weird year. But I look forward to going back. But I'm opening up to some of these ideas of voting by mail and stuff. I'm not necessarily,
as long as it's secure.
I'm not necessarily against those things, but it has to be secure. And if the people who want to implement those things are get wrapped around the axle over something as simple as a voter ID, then I'm going to be pretty skeptical of what they're proposing. So,
well, you know, not just voter ID. Let's go back to Texas and these knucklehead Dems that got on a plane loaded with beer and took off and went to an intergalactic kegger party somewhere and spread COVID. You know, well, if you look,
that sounds like a good time. I would have got on that plane.
Yeah, probably would have too. If you look at, you know, what they want to do in Texas, there's just nothing unreasonable that they're asking for. And then you have President Biden, who's out there ripping on Texas and these other states, and you take a look at the state he's from, Delaware, look at how strict their voting laws are in Delaware.
It's harder to vote in Delaware than it is in Texas, just so we're clear on that.
So it's just like...
And listen, I'm not begrudging Delaware their laws either. I'm not like trying to make it seem like Delaware's done something wrong.
He's a hypocrite.
You know, but come on. So how do we stop some of this? Like how
you
do
can.
We? Because there's obviously constituencies. There's obviously constituencies that are cheering these Democrats on as they're getting on the plane and they're flying from Texas. And you have the news media all there to these new media darlings. How do we knock this crap off and just say, just do your damn jobs? You know, you're gonna lose the debate sometimes. It doesn't matter. There's always another election coming. There's always another legislative session coming. Just show up and do your jobs. If you lose this time around, accept the loss. Try to win next time.
Yeah. Don't sit there and spend now 2 years or 4 years, whatever it is, investigating and calling these committees and everything else. The only way this garbage is gonna stop, we have to vote folks out. But that just doesn't happen. You look at like crazy Nancy Pelosi. How long has she been in office? And she keeps getting reelected back. Look at this AOC. Is she going to get booted out? I mean, here's a woman that basically, her and others, they're backing the Cuban regime down there.
Yeah.
And she'll probably get reelected. I hope not, but she probably will.
I don't think anything's going to change. until Democrats are willing to hold their own responsible, and the same for Republicans. You know, until you're willing to say that is an invalid tactic, that is an unfair thing to say, engage in the process. It's not going to happen until we exercise, until there's some risk for what they're doing. Because you're right, Nancy Pelosi, AOC, or some of these Republican guys who are from safe districts, who get away with whatever they want, none are coming to mind, but they're out there. This isn't just a Democrat problem. Until we're willing, like Matt Gaetz, by the way, how is Matt Gaetz still in the U.S. House of Representatives? That is a disgrace. But people out there, they're showing up to his rallies. They're cheering him on. Until we stop that stuff, none of this is going to change.
Well, again, you know, now you've got, and again, I don't know how serious Lindsey Graham is with this when he makes the comments. Well, you know, the Dems got a big vote. I think the big vote that he was talking about was the border and immigration and all that stuff. You know, we get on a plane and we're going to take off. Again, we'll see if it happens. But if it does happen, the Republicans, you made a massive mistake. Do not play that game. And you're right. Somebody's got to step up, be the adult, and start holding their own party accountable for stupid stuff that they do.
Agreed. Well, Jay, I'll be joining you later this afternoon on the Jay Thomas Show. I think we're going to talk about a prize-winning photograph at a county fair.
Oh, jeez. This is another one. Yeah. I mean, wow. People are upset because of this photo that won a prize at the
Pennington
like
Minnesota
County Fair.
People like to be outraged. There's a whole business model around just telling people things that make them mad. You know, that's a whole – I don't get it. But we'll be talking about that. Catch me on Jay Thomas Show, WDAY, at 2 p.m. Jay, thanks for your time.
Thanks, bro.